Hello everyone, welcome back to this series called Finance Current Affairs. So in this very series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try and discuss them with the help of different questions. So before moving on to question number one, if you haven't subscribed to our channel, please do subscribe and hit the bell icon so that you can be notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group. The link is in the description below. If you want the free PDFs of these sessions, all those things will be available on this very group only. Moving on to first question then, which says, identify the correct features of the sovereign gold bond scheme. So let's first discuss what is this sovereign gold bond scheme and why we are discussing it recently, what is the latest news about it. Then we'll come back to the question and answer it. So recently, if you have gone through the RBI website, you would have seen this very notification which says that the Government of India, in consultation with RBI, is now again issuing the sovereign gold bonds. So they have released the calendar for the upcoming year where they will be issuing the sovereign gold bonds. So these bonds will be issued in four tranches, starting from October 2021, continuing till March 2022. So these are the dates of subscription and the date for subscribing to these bonds and the date of issuance of these bonds. And RBI has also provided the details as to who will be the eligible investors, how they can buy these bonds, basically who will be the selling agencies, what should be the minimum investment amount, what can be the maximum investment limit, what will be the interest rates, what will be the denomination, everything has been provided in this notification. And those details are usually the same every time a new sovereign gold bond issue comes up. Okay, so if we will be able to understand about the sovereign gold bond scheme, which was launched in the year 2015, we'll be able to understand what are the key features as well. So abhi calendar release hua hai ki kab sovereign gold bonds ka issue karegi RBI, theek hai? आप एज अ इन्वेस्टर उसमें इन्वेस्ट कर सकते हो. सो सॉवरेन गोल्ड बॉन्ड स्कीम जो है ये 2015 में लाई गई थी. क्यों लाई गई थी, इसके क्या की फीचर्स है, वो फीचर्स अभी भी इस बॉन्ड इशू में एप्लीकेबल होंगे, वो सारे फीचर्स अब हम डिस्कस करते हैं. सो इफ आई टॉक अबाउट द की फीचर्स, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल दिस स्कीम वॉज लॉन्च एज आई हैव टोल्ड यू इन 2015. वॉट वॉज द ऑब्जेक्टिव बिहाइंड दिस स्कीम? It came up to substitute the physical gold with bond having fixed rate of interest. So these are the sovereign gold bonds. So instead of holding the gold in a physical form, you can have bonds issued. Okay, you can buy the bonds, you can subscribe for the bonds, and those bonds will be denominated in terms of gold. So when you are going to redeem the bonds, you will get whatever is the value prevailing of gold to which these bonds are linked. So aap कैश देके ये बॉन्ड खरीदोगे और जब रिडीम करोगे तो आपको उसके बदले कैश मिलेगा और वो डिपेंड करेगा कि गोल्ड की वैल्यू क्या है. सो ये बेसिकली गोल्ड में डिनोमिनेटेड होते हैं, इसलिए इनको हम सॉवरन गोल्ड बॉन्ड्स कहते हैं. सॉवरन गोल्ड बॉन्ड्स क्यों? दे आर बींग इशूड बाय आरबीआई, दे आर डिनोमिनेटेड इन टर्म्स ऑफ गोल्ड एंड दे आर बॉन्ड्स. सो द नेम सॉवरन गोल्ड बॉन्ड्स केम अप. सो सॉवरन गोल्ड बॉन्ड्स आर द गवर्नमेंट सिक्योरिटीज विच आर इशूड बाय आरबीआई बट दे आर डिनोमिनेटेड इन टर्म्स ऑफ गोल्ड. So you are subscribing to these bonds, okay, and later on when you redeem, you will get the money. So if the value of the gold would have appreciated, you might get more value. Along with that, you will also earn some interest on these bonds. So investors have to pay issue price in cash, and when the bonds are redeemed in after maturity, then again you will be receiving the cash. Now the question arises, who is an eligible investor? Can you or me invest in these bonds? Or there are some restrictions on the investments. So if I talk about the eligibility, all the resident individuals can invest in these bonds. Okay, so resident individuals is important. Other than that, the Hindu undivided family, the trusts, the universities, the charitable institutions can also invest on their behalf on these sovereign gold bonds. Okay. सो जितने भी रेसिडेंट इंडिविजुअल्स हैं, हिंदू अनडिवाइडेड फैमिलीज हैं, ट्रस्ट्स हैं, यूनिवर्सिटीज़ हैं, चैरिटेबल इंस्टीट्यूशंस हैं, वो सब सॉवरेन गोल्ड बॉन्ड्स इशू कर सकते हैं, बेसिकली सॉवरेन गोल्ड बॉन्ड्स को खरीद सकते हैं. देन टॉकिंग अबाउट द सेलिंग एजेंसीज, कौन सी एजेंसीज हैं जिनके पास पावर है कि वो सॉवरेन गोल्ड बॉन्ड्स सेल करेंगे? सो द कमर्शियल बैंक्स, द स्टॉक होल्डिंग कॉर्पोरेशन ऑफ इंडिया, the designated post offices and the stock exchanges, the recognized stock exchanges, your BSE and NSE. they have the power to sell these bonds. So commercial bank, stock holding corporation, post office, और जो हमारे recognized stock exchange है, Bombay Stock Exchange and the National Stock Exchange, ये हमारी selling agencies रहेंगी जो इन bonds में deal करेंगी. Then what is the minimum investment required in this these bonds and what's the maximum limit? So minimum you have to go for an investment of at least 1 gram of gold. 1 gram of gold जितना भी small ये SGB के units denote करेगा, आपको minimum उतना investment करना होगा. Okay. So minimum of 1 gram of gold you have to go for if you want to invest in these sovereign gold bonds. There is upper limit which differs for individuals and for the trusts. So the upper limit for your individuals and your Hindu undivided families is 4 kilograms. That is 4,000 units per financial year. So एक साल में आप sovereign gold bonds में 4 kilo gold से ज़्यादा का investment नहीं कर सकते. Basically 4,000 units of the sovereign gold bond. And if I talk about the trusts and similar entities, the maximum limit is 20 kilograms of gold. Okay, so retail investors or Hindu undivided family ke liye 4 kgs hai, and for trusts and similar entities, 20 kgs. Then talking about what's the interest rate being earned on these bonds, so 2.5% is the interest rate. Then talking about the term, so if you are buying these bonds, you have to hold them for a period of 8 years. Okay, so their maturity period is 8 years, after which you can redeem them and get the cash. Okay, whatever return you want, you will be getting that based on what's the value prevailing of gold. But there is also an option that if you don't want to hold it for a more longer period, then there is an option to exit from these bonds, but after 5 years. So 5 saal tak to aapko ye bonds hold karke rakhne hai, uske baad aap isko इससे एग्जिट कर सकते हो. लेकिन अगर आप 8 years तक होल्ड करके रखोगे तो आपको और बेनिफिट्स मिलेंगे, आपको बेटर रिटर्न्स मिलेंगे, टैक्स बेनिफिट्स मिलेंगे, ऑल दोज थिंग्स आर देयर. सो व्हाट इज द रीजन व्हाई एन इन्वेस्टर माइट प्रेफर गोइंग फॉर अ सॉवरेन गोल्ड बॉन्ड विज़िवी गोइंग फॉर अदर इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स और विज़िवी होल्डिंग द गोल्ड इन अ फिजिकल फॉर्म. आप गोल्ड ना खरीद के सॉवरेन गोल्ड बॉन्ड क्यों खरीदोगे या कोई और इन्वेस्टमेंट ना करके यहाँ क्यों इन्वेस्ट करोगे? कुछ तो बेनिफिट्स होंगे, कुछ फायदे होंगे, तभी आप ऐसा करोगे. So the benefits include first that these bonds can be used as collateral for loans. So if you want to raise a loan, you can provide these bonds as a collateral. Obviously they have a RBI backing, so they are a reliable source. They can be used as a collateral. Then the capital gains tax is exempted. If you are earning some capital gains on these sovereign gold bonds, then you will be exempted from paying tax on that. Also they offer you attractive interest rate and asset appreciation opportunity. You will be getting the interest rate and also at the time of maturity, whatever is the value prevailing, that appreciated value you will be getting. Aaj aapne investment kiya, future mein 8 saal baad jaake uski value badal jayegi. Aapko interest bhi milega itne saalon ka aur aapko wo appreciated value bhi milegi maturity pe jab aap redeem karoge. So that's the benefit. Then it's free from issues like making charges, purity like in case of jewelry or the gold storage charges or the risks. So if you are holding the gold in a physical form, अगर आपने jewelry खरीद ली gold की sovereign gold bond खरीदने के बजाय, आपको उसके jewelry making charges भी देने पड़ते हैं. ठीक है, ऐसे तो आपको gold नहीं मिल जाता, आपको कुछ charges देने पड़ते हैं क्योंकि वो jewelry form में created है. या अब आपको ये भी risk है कि जो आप gold खरीद रहे हो वो pure है कि नहीं है. ओके, कितने frauds होते हैं. देन अब आपने गोल्ड लिया तो उसको आपको कहीं लॉकर में या कहीं पे सेफली रखना है, रिस्क है कि चोरी ना हो जाए. सो ऑल दोज रिस्क्स आर देयर, द रिस्क ऑफ थेफ्ट, द रिस्क ऑफ कीपिंग द गोल्ड सेफ, कीपिंग इट इन लॉकर्स एंड इनकरिंग द कॉस्ट, पेइंग द कॉस्ट, एक्स्ट्रा कॉस्ट फॉर मेकिंग चार्जेस इन केस यू आर हैविंग द गोल्ड इन अ ज्वेलरी फॉर्म. ओके, देन देर आर रिस्क एज टू वेदर द गोल्ड यू आर बाइंग इज प्योर और नॉट. सो ऑल दीज थिंग्स विल और ऑल दीज इशूज कैन बी overcome, if you can overcome these issues if you are going for a sovereign gold bond vis-a-vis a physical gold, okay, in physical gold investment. Now coming back to our question, we have to identify the correct features of the scheme. So the minimum investment is 1 gram, this is correct. Fixed rate of 3.5% is there, no, 2.5%, it's incorrect. Then bonds can be sold through commercial banks, stock holding corporation, BSE, NSE, designated post office, this is correct. So first and third are correct, answer is option C. Moving to second question then. It says, which of the following is the leading public sector undertaking? Leading public sector undertaking that became the first NBFC to raise $75 million 5-year secured overnight finance rate linked syndicated term loan from an international bank. So you have to identify the NBFC which has raised a loan, a SOFR linked loan. So if you remember, we discussed about LIBOR and the cessation of LIBOR, that RBI is asking to shift from LIBOR to some other alternative reference rate. And one of such alternate reference rates is this SOFR. So we have to identify the public sector undertaking, which is the first NBFC in India that has recently decided, or in fact raised, a loan which is not linked to LIBOR but to SOFR. So the answer to this question is option B. It's the Rural Electrification Corporation. Let's first discuss what is LIBOR, what is SOFR, and what's the current news going on regarding this. Okay. So talking about LIBOR, LIBOR stands for the London Interbank Offered Rate. जिस रेट पे आपस में लंदन के मेजर बैंक्स एक दूसरे को पैसा लेंड करने को रेडी है, उस रेट का एक काइंड ऑफ एवरेज होता है आपका LIBOR. अलग अलग मेजर बैंक से पूछा जाता है कि आप किस रेट पे लोन लेने को रेडी हो, उसकी एक एवरेज निकाली जाती थी और ये रेट डिटरमाइन होता था. ये कई जगह पे लोन्स वगैरह देने के लिए एज अ रेफरेंस रेट यूज किया जाता था, लेकिन क्योंकि बैंक्स खुद ये रेट देते हैं तो वो इस रेट को मैनिपुलेट कर रहे थे. जब मेजर बैंक्स ने पैसा लेंड करना होता था तो वो आपस में एक तरह से अलायंस बना के ऐसा रेट कोट करते थे कि उन्हें ज़्यादा रेट उस पर इंटरेस्ट मिले, और जब उन्होंने बोरो करना होता था तो वो एक अलायंस बना के ऐसा रेट कोट करते थे कि उनको, क्योंकि बोरो करना है तो कम रेट पे लोन मिल जाए. तो जान के ये रेट मैनिपुलेट किया जा रहा था, जिस वजह से काफ़ी कंट्रीज ने LIBOR से शिफ्ट करना शुरू कर दिया. एंड इनफैक्ट RBI ने भी कहा कि अब LIBOR ना यूज़ करके आप कोई और रेफरेंस रेट यूज़ करना शुरू करो. So telling this you in English as well for those who haven't understood. So LIBOR is basically a rate which is quoted by the major banks of London. They quoted a rate at which they are willing to lend and borrow from each other. Okay, so based on an average of that rate, a rate was determined called LIBOR. It was used as a reference rate for various loans. But because the banks were themselves providing this rate, okay, the major banks were themselves providing this rate, they were manipulating the rate. If they had to take a loan, then they made an alliance and quoted a lower rate because they had to borrow. And when they had to lend this money, they formed kind of an alliance, an informal alliance, to make sure that the rate quoted is higher so that they can lend at a higher rate. So manipulation was going on, because of which various countries decided that we will shift from LIBOR to some other rate. Okay, RBI also said that we should go for cessation of LIBOR and shift to some other alternate rate. So now other rates are being adopted, and one of them being the SOFR. SOFR एक बहुत ही major alternate rate है जो LIBOR की जगह अब use करना शुरू कर दिया है countries ने, और India में भी इसका usage अब शुरू हो गया है. Many countries have started opting for SOFR including India. SOFR stands for Secured Overnight Financing Rate. So it is also a reference rate, but the way it is determined differs from LIBOR. LIBOR में banks अपने आप rate बताते थे, यहाँ पे banks का नहीं है. यहाँ पे कैसे decide होता है, जैसे banks India के case में RBI से repo rate पे borrow करते हैं against some collateral, तो ऐसे ही internationally US में भी borrowings होती हैं repo rates पे from their central bank. So actual उस ट्रांजैक्शन की कॉस्ट कितनी आ रही है, गवर्नमेंट बॉन्ड्स ऐसे कोलेटरल दे के जो आप ओवरनाइट रेपो रेट्स पे लोन रेज कर रहे हो, उसकी एक्चुअल ट्रांजैक्शन कॉस्ट के बेसिस पे ये SOFR डिटरमाइन होता है. तो ये एक अलग वे से डिटरमाइन होता है, इसलिए ये लेस रिस्की और रिलायबल सोर्स है. सो इफ आई टॉक अबाउट SOFR, हाउ इट डिफर्स फ्रॉम LIBOR. सी इन LIBOR द बैंक्स देमसेल्फ्स कोटेड द रेट, बट इन SOFR एट व्हाटएवर रेट the banks are borrowing from their central bank in New York, that repo, that overnight repo rate is used to calculate the SOFR. So whatever actual cost is incurred when you are raising the overnight repo loans from the Federal Reserve against providing the government bonds as a collateral, that actual cost is used to determine the SOFR. So it is calculated in a different way, and that's less risky and reliable because there is Federal Reserve involved over there. ठीक है, तो जो सो वट एवर इज द एक्चुअल कॉस्ट ऑफ ट्रांजेक्शन इन ओवरनाइट रेपो अगेंस्ट द गवर्नमेंट बॉन्ड्स बीइंग प्रोवाइडेड एज अ कोलैटरल, दैट एक्चुअल कॉस्ट हेल्प्स डिटरमाइन द एसओएफआर विद मोर अ रिलायबल ऑल्टरनेट रेफरेंस रेट. सो वॉट्स द करंट न्यूज गोइंग ऑन? Recently, a public sector undertaking, basically a central public sector undertaking called the Rural Electrification Corporation, it raised a loan, a major loan, which was linked to SOFR. So, a syndicated term loan in order raised kiya hai internationally, international corporation se, jo ki linked hai LIBOR se nahi balki SOFR se. It's linked to SOFR. Okay, so it became the first NBFC in India, first Indian NBFC in fact, to go for a loan linked to SOFR. Alright, so not only this, it has also entered into an interest rate swap where SOFR is being used as a reference rate. The proceeds of this facility will be used to fund infrastructure power projects. So, जो भी ये लोन रेज किया गया है SOFR रेट से जो लिंक है, इस लोन को अब इस पैसे को अब यूज किया जाएगा वेरियस इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर पावर सेक्टर प्रोजेक्ट्स में जो ये कंपनी रन करती है. सो व्हाई वी आर डिस्कसिंग इट, व्हाई इज इट इम्पॉर्टेंट? बिकॉज आरबीआई हैज आस्क्ड फॉर सेसेशन ऑफ लाइबोर एंड नाउ देयर इज अ नीड टू शिफ्ट टू ऑल्टरनेट रेफरेंस रेट. सो डिफरेंट फर्म्स हैव स्टार्टेड शिफ्टिंग टू सम ऑल्टरनेट रेफरेंस रेट एंड दिस कंपनी बीइंग अ मेजर पब्लिक सेक्टर कंपनी हैज रेज्ड अ लोन लिंक्ड टू एसओएफआर. इट्स एन इम्पॉर्टेंट पॉइंट टू बी नोटेड. ओके, and the notification from it basically shows that the implementation of RBI notification has started. Now talking about a bit more about this company REC, so it's a Navratna NBFC. This thing is important that what are Navratna companies. Okay, so REC ek aise hi koi company nahi hai, ye Navratna public sector enterprise hai jisne ye SOFR linked loan raise kiya hai. It's basically a company that deals in providing the financial assistance to the state governments, to the state electricity boards, to various independent power producers, basically dealing in the power sector. Okay, it deals in projects of generating, transmitting, distributing the energy projects. Now talking about the Navratna companies, so the central public sector enterprises are classified under three categories. Jo central public sector enterprises hai unhe teen categories mein baanta gaya hai, alag alag criteria hai unhe in categories mein baantne ke, Navratna company, mini ratna company aur ma ratna company. So first of all, mini ratna companies further have two categories. Their criteria is that if you have made profit for last 3 years or earned a net profit of 30 crore or more in the 3 years, then you are a mini ratna category 1. Similarly, we have some criteria for category 2. So what's a Navratna company? Jo mini ratna company reh chuki hai, wo company jab 4 independent directors rakhti hai apne board mein aur kuch parameters jo bataye gaye hain unme wo 100 mein se 60 ka score lati hai. Wo parameters hain aapke net profit, net worth, manpower cost, total प्रोडक्शन की कॉस्ट, सर्विस की कॉस्ट, प्रॉफिट्स जो आप अर्न कर रहे हो, कैपिटल जो आप एम्प्लॉय कर रहे हो, उसमें 60 का स्कोर लाती है एटलीस्ट आउट ऑफ 100. और पहले मिनी रत्ना कंपनी रह चुकी है, उस कंपनी को हम नवरत्ना कंपनी में कैटेगराइज करते हैं. ओके, सो द कंपनी विच हैज रिमेन्ड अ मिनी रत्ना कंपनी, विच हैज 4 इंडिपेंडेंट डायरेक्टर्स ऑन इट्स बोर्ड एंड विच स्कोर्स विच बेसिकली गेट्स अ स्कोर ऑफ 60 आउट ऑफ 100 ऑन वेरियस पैरामीटर्स लाइक total manpower cost, total cost of production, cost of service, net profit, net worth, that the company is a Navratna company. So why the central public sector enterprises are classified under these categories? Because each of these categories is offered certain benefits. Like if I talk about Navratna company, it can invest up to 1000 crore for which it does not need a government approval. Similarly, we have other set of benefits for Maharatna or Miniratna companies as well. So this was a bit of extra knowledge about Navratna companies. In India, these 4 are the Navratna companies. You might have heard the name of Bharat Electronics Limited, Oil India Limited, and the Power Finance Corporation. So this is the list of those companies, REC being one of them. ठीक है? तो एक नवरत्ना कंपनी ने SOFR linked loan raise किया है, ये news थी. इसमें आपको ये पता होना चाहिए कि LIBOR क्या था, हमने LIBOR से shift करना क्यों prefer किया, और ये SOFR क्या है. Alright. Now moving to next question, the last question, which says, which of the following is an example of a bank assurance agreement? So let's first discuss what's a bank assurance agreement, what's the latest news regarding this, and then we'll come back to the question and answer it. So recently, Bharti AXA Life Insurance Company has entered into a bank assurance partnership with a small finance bank called the Utkarsh Small Finance Bank to ensure distribution of life insurance product through banks network across India. So Bharti Life Insurance Company and Utkarsh Small Finance Banks have come into an agreement. As per this agreement, the life insurance company will be selling its life insurance products to the customers of small finance banks. So यहाँ क्या हो रहा है, एक लाइफ इंश्योरेंस कंपनी है, वो लाइफ इंश्योरेंस कंपनी ने एक बैंक के साथ अग्री किया है, एक पार्टनरशिप की है, और ये दोनों अब मिलके वर्क करेंगे जहाँ ये लाइफ इंश्योरेंस कंपनी अपने प्रोडक्ट्स इस बैंक के कस्टमर्स को सेल करेगी। सो ये अग्रीमेंट जहाँ पे एक इंश्योरेंस कंपनी और एक बैंक साथ में आते हैं, कोलैबोरेट करते हैं, एक दूसरे को बेनिफिट प्रोवाइड करते हैं, उस अग्रीमेंट को हम कहते हैं बैंक अश्योरेंस। बैंक providing insurance while getting linked up with the insurance company, bank assurance name यहाँ से आया है। अब इससे ऐसी agreement में bank और एक insurance company क्यों आएंगे, क्योंकि इन दोनों को ही फायदा होगा, both of them are going to benefit from this collaboration, that's why they come into a such kind of a partnership. Like if I talk about this very case only, Bharti AXA insurance company will be able to sell its insurance product to the major customer base of the bank. Okay, so bank has around 3 million customers in 600 branches, 200 districts, 19 states, 2 union territories. So this insurance company will get the access to these customers. It will ensure selling more of its insurance products. Bank will be earning something out of this. It might charge some fee from this life insurance company. Moreover, the customers of bank will get the convenience of insurance services as well. So bank ke customer ko bank ki service to milengi, saath saath insurance bhi milengi, to customers ke liye convenient ho jayega. Iske alawa life insurance company ko aur customers mil jayenge aur bank unse kuch fee charge kar lega uski, to bank ko bhi profit mil jayega. So aapas mein sabko fayda hoga, isliye ye agreement hoti hai. So talking about this agreement, as I've already discussed, it's an arrangement between a bank and an insurance company wherein the bank allows the insurance company to sell its products to their clients. Okay, so it means selling insurance products through banks. Banks and insurance company come in partnership wherein the bank sells the insurance company's insurance products to its clients. So iske benefits kya hai, let's discuss them one by one. Bank earns some fee from the insurance company, so bank ke liye earning ka zariya ho gaya hai, theek hai. For insurance firm increases its market reach and customers, so insurance firm ki reach badhti hai, its market share increases, uski reach badhegi, jyada customers tak pahunch payegi, to unka obviously market share badhega. Okay, it provides the benefits to the customer, the convenience customer ke liye convenient ho jayega kyunki unhe insurance aur banking services saath mein mil jayengi. Customers will get the insurance and banking services together at the same place. Banks and insurance company will benefit, their revenue will increase, greater volume, more profits for both the players. So dono ko hi profits badhenge, theek hai. Ye kuch benefits hai because of which the firms agree. If you remember many days back, in fact months back, I believe I discussed a bank assurance agreement with you which happened at that point in time. So there I framed the question in such a way that there was a case study and you had to identify what's the concept being talked about. Today I have changed the way the question can be asked. Here I have told you that it's a bank assurance agreement. I have given you three examples and you have to identify the correct ones, which basically talk about a bank assurance agreement. So let's read them one by one. The first one says Bharti AXA entered into a partnership with Utkarsh Small Finance Bank to distribute insurance product through banks network. So ye abhi humne discuss kiya, ye bank assurance ka example obviously hai. Then SBI General Insurance signed an agreement with IDFC First Bank to distribute non-life insurance product. Although the bank and insurance company are agreeing for a non-life insurance solution, but obviously insurance products are being sold through a collaboration between a bank and an insurance company, so it's again a bank assurance agreement. Third one says Yes Bank, it's a bank, okay, and India Housing Finance, we can say it's an NBFC. So a bank and an NBFC are entering into an agreement to together offer home loans to home buyers. So kya ye bank assurance agreement hai? Is it a bank assurance agreement? No. Here a bank and an NBFC are coming up together to lend loans. So it's a co-lending agreement. Jahan bank aur NBFC saath aate hain. ताकि बैंक का मेजर कस्टमर बेस एनबीएफसी को मिल सके और एनबीएफसी की रीच जो है वो बैंक्स के कस्टमर्स को फायदा पहुंचा सके, दोनों को बेनिफिट हो, उस अग्रीमेंट को हम को लेंडिंग अग्रीमेंट कहते हैं। सो दिस इज एन एग्जाम्पल ऑफ को लेंडिंग, नॉट ऑफ बैंक अश्योरेंस। सो ओनली फर्स्ट एंड सेकेंड आर दी एग्जाम्पल्स, आंसर इज ऑप्शन बी। दिस वॉज ऑल फॉर टूडेज सेशन, आई होप दिस सेशन वॉज यूजफुल फॉर यू ऑल। With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.